Hi, my name is Mike Denton. I've been a critic of Darwinism most of my life, and I'm very excited about the fact that there's a Polish group going to translate into Polish my first book, Evolution, a Theory in Crisis, and my second book, my follow-up book, Evolution, Still a Theory in Crisis. And I hope it will encourage Polish readers to investigate and involve themselves in the great debate about the causation of evolution and the question of design in nature. I'm a medical geneticist, and I spent most of my academic life collecting family genetic diseases in South Asia. And the reason why I went to South Asia is that, in fact, big families and people marry near relatives. So if you're looking for recessive diseases, it's an ideal place to collect families. And so I started that work in the late 80s, and then in the 90s and the first decade of the 20th century. So that was a major career of mine. But I also did a medical degree in Bristol, and I did a PhD in King's in London, just after the double helix. And I actually worked in the same cold room that they crystallized DNA in the Thames, in the clay of the Thames. Because I was doing some work on the development of the red cell, and I needed a very vibrational free place to carry out some of my work. And so it was very exciting, the very place where Rosalind Franklin, you know, and the people at King's had crystallized DNA. There was the very place where I was working. So it was wonderful. These were the glory days of the molecular biological revolution, when, you know, everything was going to be explained. You know, it was very, very exciting. So medicine at Bristol, PhD at King's, and then I did other things, of course, as well. But eventually I settled down to do medical genetics. And so I spent many years in India and Pakistan and other places collecting families with genetic diseases, sending them to Moorfields in London, sending them to NIH. Yeah, basically it was the PhD work I was doing at King's. I was studying the development of the red blood cell. And now the red blood cell carries out one of the most important physiological functions on Earth. It delivers oxygen, from the lungs to the tissues. And it's an enucleate cell. It doesn't have a nucleus. And the first question was, how did it sort of evolve in Darwinian fashion to have no nucleus? Because you either have a nucleus in the cell or it's not in the cell. What were the intermediates between a cell with a nucleus and a cell without a nucleus for selection to sort of, you know, incrementally move from one state to another? So it struck me that was very difficult to explain. But on top of that, I was aware that birds, for instance, keep the nucleus, whereas mammals lose the nucleus. And yet birds have a higher demand for oxygen than us mammals, right? They have a higher metabolic rate, and of course birds, you know, it's because of flight, very, very energy demanding. They keep the nucleus. So what was the adaptive reason for getting rid of the nucleus, you see? And so when I thought about the red cell over those years when I was doing a PhD, I could not give a Darwinian explanation of the enucleate red cell in a mammal. And I knew that this was performing one of the most vital physiological functions on Earth. And here was something which I couldn't explain. And that was one of the major factors in me thinking, wow, you know, this theory is wrong, and I should start doing something about it. I sent the manuscript of that book to over 100 publishers before rejection after rejection after rejection. I'm crazy, it's mad, and this sort of thing. Yeah, so it was very difficult to get a publisher to take it. I did get a publisher eventually in London to take it, and then it was taken up in the States, right? But certainly it was hard to get it into print. When it did get into print, it was sort of savaged by the Darwinian sort of establishment. However, in fact, it did get surprisingly one or two good reviews from mainstream academics, which, you know, it's always nice, you know, it's always nice to get one or two reviews anyway. And of course, it eventually had quite an impact because it was the only book at that time. There was one or two other books, like On the Origin of Life, like Thaxton's book, I've forgotten the name of it, but there was one or two books, but that was the only book that attempted to give a comprehensive critique of the Darwinian worldview completely, you know, sort of emphasizing the gaps in the fossil record and the mysteries of homology, the complexity of biological systems and so forth. The essential argument was that many of the structures in nature seem to be unavailable to a continuous pathway of change. You know, that was the essential core argument of the book. You know. So, but it was savaged by lots of people, but it did get one or two good reviews, so you know. The core concept was that in fact many things in biology, from you know hands to feet to feathers to the bird's lung, many things seem to be you can't approach them in terms of little steps. And Darwinism is entirely dependent on gradualism and small steps, just as we heard from Gunter at this meeting, right? Once you have isolated structures and you have discontinuity in nature, it's very difficult to imagine how those objects or whatever could have come about gradually, bit by bit, because there's not a pathway there. Since the first book was published, there's been really a lot of mainstream academic biologists who have voiced all sorts of concerns about Darwinism, saying things like macroevolution can't be explained in terms of microevolution. People like Stephen Jay Gould stressing that the fossil record was, you know, discontinuous and things like this. So there's been a lot of sort of mainstream critiques of Darwinism. None of these critics support intelligent design, but they're critics of Darwinism, right? And so that's one of the things that's happened. That stream of criticism wasn't present in academic world when I wrote the first book. So that's one thing that's happened. Personally, I've also come to see that, in fact, there are other features of biology which I was really unaware of, which also challenged Darwinism, such as, for instance, the vast amount of what you might call non-adaptive order in biological systems. When I wrote the first book, it was written from a functionalist point of view, and it was a critique of Darwinism on functional grounds. You can't go in little functional steps to get these various things, feathers and blah blah blah. What I found since the first book was that there's a lot of other stuff in nature which is not adaptive, and that also poses a huge challenge to Darwinism, almost a definitional challenge, because what is not adaptive can't be explained by definition in terms of a model which serves particular ends. Yeah. Well, the second book is focused on really on non-adaptive order. So the first book was focused on adaptive structures in biology, and arguing that Darwinism can't explain them. The second book is focused on, once again, it's focused on gaps in nature, but it's also focused on non-adaptive order. Like, for example, take different species of daisies. Mm-hmm. One will have, say, 14 petals, the other one will have 18 petals, the other one will have 24 petals, and so forth. These sorts of phenomena permeate the whole of nature, and you can't explain them in terms of any adaptive structure. And so that means that you don't really have to argue against Darwinism, because that range of phenomena are out of the range of any form of adaptive explanation. So by definition, you can't account for them in terms of Darwinian selection. So that's the main core of the book. But it also goes through lots of problems like the origin of life, the origin of feathers, the origin of many specific things. Showing again, really, that you can't get them in terms of Darwinism. I'm on the edge of skepticism about theism myself. First of all, let me make a point. My first book and the second book are basically criticisms of Darwinism. The first book is a criticism of Darwinian selectionism. The second book says there's a lot of order in biology, which by definition you can't really explain in terms of Darwinism. But they're not attempts to defend intelligent design. They're critiques of Darwinism. Right? But I did write another book called Nature's Destiny. Mm-hmm. And that was, in fact, that was a book that covered a lot of the ground I talked about today. And that was, in fact, that will be defending intelligent design. As far as your hint is that, in fact, you know, you can only be an intelligent designer if you have some a priori theological or religious view, I disagree with that entirely, because it doesn't apply to me. Most of my life I've been pretty agnostic, mm-hmm. and would describe myself perhaps as a backslidden Christian, but I'm not in any sense a fervent believer in a God or the Christian God. So in my case, it doesn't apply. And for me, there is what all the physicists would agree. If you look at the constants of physics, all of them, like Paul Davis will say, the impression of design is overwhelming. The stuff I presented this morning, the impression design is overwhelming to me. Mm-hmm. And I can say that so that I'm inferring here design, but I really would insist absolutely that I'm not doing that for religious reasons or for any religious a priori. You know, I'm just looking at the evidence, and that's where the evidence seems to be pointing. I can only repeat what I've just said, that in fact, if you look at the fine-tuning evidence in nature, I think that very strongly suggests there's some intelligence behind the universe. Mm-hmm. I'm not so convinced of the intelligent design inferences from special adaptations, humans have pains, we have problems and things like this. But the overall picture of the cosmos looks to me as if it was fabricated for life and even for beings of our physiology and biology. It looks as if it is, right? And that's certainly a view held by many physicists, and it's certainly my view looking at the biological evidence. So I think it's an inference to a good explanation. Whether it's the best explanation, but it's an inference to a good explanation. And I would insist that it's really, from me, and from people like Paul Davis in the physical area, in the area of physics, I think that in fact, basically, there's a lot of people arguing that this evidence suggests design who are not religious. Mm-hmm. Barrow, Tipler, Davis, mm-hmm. Fred Hoyle, and things like this. Yeah, these are the physicists. My current research is I'm preparing a long, lengthy book, which is going to be which will document all the fine-tuning in nature necessary for the biological world, for our physiology, for the existence of the first cell, and so forth. So hopefully it's a comprehensive documentation of all the fitness that science has so far discovered for life on Earth. And it's a very satisfying project. That's my next book. That's my next major book after, Evolution was a major book, Nature Destiny was a good book, and then I went into Evolution Still a Theory in Crisis. But this is my sort of magnus opus. That's the book I want to leave as my sort of, my signature, actually. Yeah.